Hi, welcome to Microsoft Virtual Academy, the session on software development fundamentals. We're in module 5. We're going to be talking about desktop applications in this module. My name is Paul Pardee, and I'm a content development lead with Microsoft, and I'm here with Jerry O'Brien.
Hi, and as Paul said, welcome to module number 5 for our Software Development Fundamentals MVA. My name is Jerry O'Brien. I'm a technical content development manager here at Microsoft. And we're going to take a look at some examples of desktop applications. So these are, this module is designed to give you an overview of what you might expect to encounter for developing applications that will run on standard desktops, laptops, servers, anything that is non-smartphone, mobile platform, or web-based types of applications. So we're going to take a look at three different types of desktop applications in this module here. We'll give an overview of them, we'll talk a little bit about what they consist of and a demonstration of what some of them look like. And we're going to cover the graphical user interface applications, we'll demonstrate console-based apps, and then we'll have a little discussion on Windows services applications as well. So GUI-based or graphical user interface-based applications came about back in the days when Microsoft started introducing Windows 3, 3.0, 3.1. Apple was working on the Apple OS, and graphical user interface applications have specific attributes or characteristics, if you will, that we use to determine whether it's a GUI-based application or not. Some of those, as we look on our slide here, is they consist of a graphical interface. So again, think of all of your Windows applications that you interact with on a day-to-day basis. Microsoft Word, PowerPoint, Excel, or even Internet Explorer, Firefox, the web browsers, even though they're viewing web apps, are still a desktop application, they're still a graphical user interface application. You interact with these through the use of menus, by using the mouse, keyboard shortcuts on the keyboard, or because of the introduction of Windows 8, and of course, you know, even talking about our tablets and our phones through a touch interface. So they're graphic elements. There's icons, there are squares, there's something on the application you're interacting with. And again, they're found on Windows computers, on Apple computers, Linux computers, mobile devices like Windows phones and iPhones. Those are all good examples of GUI-based applications.
And even in industrial applications like your bank ATM may have a GUI where you're touching on the screen and there's user elements there that you're interacting with.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, before I get into working in IT full-time, I used to work in the HVAC industry, and we would have applications out there. Consider about your can of Coke or Pepsi that you might have sitting there. There are certain industrial processes that control building into the carbonization of those soft drinks. And the users that work in the factories will interact with graphical environments or graphical tools to control those processes. And it's kind of like, you know, Paul talked about with the ATM machine. You've got an interface that you interact with and click and push buttons to get it to do what it is that you want it to do. So let's have a look at a couple of examples of GUI applications. Again, these would be relatively quick and straightforward because, again, you've seen GUI applications. Perfect example, we've been demonstrating through some of the code examples throughout all of this jumpstart and the previous modules. Visual Studio, this is an example of a graphical environment, so a graphical user interface. We have menus, and in order to execute the menus, we are using command buttons, mouse clicks on the different menus to get what it is that we want it to do. We have what are known as windows. So this entire frame or this border of the application is known as a window. And we can minimize it and we can move it around. It's a graphical element that exists. Also, when we consider looking at from the perspective of the touch, so this is a touch interface and I just swiped in from the right-hand side of the touch screen that I'm using. And if I touch on values such as the search, it brings something up and then I can interact by typing values in from the keyboard. So again, these are just quick examples of graphical user interface types of applications, and no different from what you're normally used to using on your computers every day, right? The ones that become a little different that not everybody has the opportunity to interact with are console-based applications. And console-based applications, unlike GUI ones or GUI-based applications, don't typically have UI elements. We don't have buttons. We don't have necessarily menu items that we would be selecting through the touch interface or through a mouse interface. Instead, we interact with those through the keyboard pretty much primarily. So they're usually command line driven, and they don't contain graphical components. Now, I've kind of listed here, they don't contain components like windows or icons. Icons are true. Windows, we can argue that point whether they actually contain windows or not, and it depends on the type of application that you're using. I always go back to, you know, my early days of getting into computers, the PC-based model outside of things like the Commodore VIC-20s that were, you know, you programmed everything yourself. But in initial days or original days of dealing with things like MS-DOS, which was a command line driven interface for the computer, there were no windows on that. Everything was driven from a console app, and you had to type all of your commands in by hand. So
Jerry, before you get to the demo, when would someone use a console-based app today, since we have so many options for GUI interfaces? What is the purpose of a command line interface today?
So it depends on really the use and what users sometimes find more convenient to use. And a good example of that is, you know, even though Windows has been a graphical environment for many, many years, we still include the command console. We still include a console-based interface inside of the Windows operating system. If you go out and you talk to a lot of your network administrators, folks who are dealing with deploying and managing multiple servers in an environment, they want to be able to automate tasks as much as possible. And the ability for them to go through and create multiple users by using the graphical interface, so, you know, Windows Server uses a concept of Active Directory, which contains all of the information about user accounts on your server and on your network and things like that. If you have an environment where you've got 20,000 users and you have to create those user accounts, this graphical interface of filling in first name, last name, you know, office phone number, clicking create, and going back and redoing it over and over again gets monotonous and it gets very time consuming. So command line based or console based applications help us to be able to do things a lot quicker by creating what are known as batch files or automating routines by writing little scripts that allow us to get that functionality sometimes a little bit quicker and easier. There still sometimes exist applications on the internet that might require command line infrastructure so that you don't deal with GUI and GUI applications or GUI environments. And specifically at one class I remember teaching a few years back, there weren't a lot of graphical FTP applications. And FTP is a file transfer protocol type of application that allows you to connect to another computer, locate files that you might want, and download them to your computer. So there weren't a whole lot of graphical-based applications for that purpose and for that process. And one of the classes I was teaching was based on internet technologies, and the FTP application was only command line based, so I was typing in commands to get it to do what it was that I wanted to do. And a lot of the students, these are obviously some younger students, definitely younger than myself, who had never seen command line based applications before, and so they weren't quite sure, what is this thing? Why can't I click this? Where are the buttons and different things like that? So they still have their purposes, although probably becoming less and less useful, I think, in today's modern ways of dealing with the programming interfaces that we have. But as we take a look at some of the applications, let's pop out into a couple of quick demos here. One of the first ones that we'll demonstrate is this command window. And as an example, if you've watched previous modules in this jumpstart, you've seen as we executed some code and the information came back and displayed, we wrote out to the console window, we got this information back in this kind of a form. So where I said we could argue that they contain a window or not, this technically is a window in the Windows environment because I can grab it and move it around and I can interact with the mouse. But really the console-based portion of it focuses on the black and white in the middle here, right? So the black background and the white text. And I can do simple things like type in commands where, DIR is something that says, give me a directory listing of the current folder that I'm in. I've got the ability to change directories. In which case I'm moving up and down the directory path, and I'm not doing this to the graphical environment. If you're not familiar with these, then you're probably more familiar with going into Windows Explorer, or if you're on something like the Macintosh, going into Finder, and you know, so you have the ability to graphically navigate through directory structures. But in this case, we're doing so through the use of commands. We're actually typing those commands in.
And how can we find out all the commands that are available?
Consult the documentation. No. That's one way. You can read a book, and it, which, you know, this is, believe it or not, it leads me back to when I don't want to date myself, and I don't want to spend too much time boring folks with some of my old war stories and computers, but when I got my first IBM-compatible PC running MS-DOS, I think it was 4.0 was the version, way back when we used to ship books with our software, we had a reference manual, a book on Microsoft DOS. So obviously when I, you know, you can imagine turning a computer on today and being presented with nothing but this interface, this black interface and white text and a cursor blinking at you, waiting for you to do something. And you know, so most users will be going, what the heck am I supposed to do? I got this computer, I just spent oodles of money on this thing and I can't get it to do anything, right? So, and that's the feeling I had. So I started going through this DOS manual, this instruction manual, to figure out what everything was. And believe it or not, I did go cover to cover on the DOS manual. And everything worked great until I got to the letter F. And there's a command in DOS called format. And as I was reading through it, I was looking at it, and I was reading the reference material, and it said, format is a command that you use to prepare your hard disk drive to store data and receive information. So I thought, yeah, great, because I want to put programs on my computer, so obviously that's what I should do. So I read through all of this, the directions, and it said if your, you know, your current hard drive is, and as we can, you know, see in our demo, you know, C colon is kind of the drive we're using, so it's like format space C colon. So I was like, hey, great, I'm going to prepare my hard drive, and I'm going to be able to put lots of applications on this thing. And I went format C colon, hit the enter key, and it popped up and said, are you sure you want to format? And, well, yes, because I just typed a command in. And pressed the letter Y and hit enter, and it went through the process of formatting my computer. I was like, hey, that was pretty cool. So now I'm ready to install applications. And everything worked great while I would continue to execute some commands, because DOS was actually stored in the memory of the computer. And then I was finished, so I shut it down for the day. And the next day I came back in, turned my computer on, and got this odd message that said, operating system not found. And I couldn't figure out why. So having said the answer to Paul's question, the read the manual, that can run you into problems sometimes. So, but what Paul is referring to is if you don't have a manual, which we typically don't have anymore, let's go back to our demo, and we'll show you if we type in the command called help, we get this scrolling screen full of all kinds of commands. So this gives you an idea or an example of what can I type in, okay? And it gives you some very rudimentary explanations of what those commands do. So, you know, like a soak is, you know, displays or modifies file extension associations. One of the things you might notice is that to save time and space and to, you know, prevent the computer user from going crazy typing commands, a lot of these were shortened. So a soak was short for associations, attrib for attributions, cd for change directory. So, you know, so to answer your question, that's kind of how we interacted with that, right, with that perspective. But in talking about the different functions and why people use things differently is, you know, Microsoft a couple of years back created this thing called PowerShell. And the network administrators, systems administrators, you know, dealing with Windows systems absolutely love this. It's integrated into a lot of Microsoft products now, such as SQL Server and Exchange, which is the email server. And again, what this does is it allows our administrators on these systems to create scripts and batch files and automate their systems through the use of command line interfaces that really streamline what it is that they're doing, right? And again, you know, PowerShell, as Paul talked about, what can I do with PowerShell? If I type help, you know, it kind of gives me an explanation. You know, it's Windows PowerShell help system. What does it do? Here's a long description. You know, and how do I gain access to more information? And it tells you, you know, if you know a command but you don't know what a command does, you can type in the command for, you know, save and help. But again, this is just an example. These are console-based applications There's no graphical environment in these at all, these other than this window that we drag around, but that's pretty much it. And you interact with it all through commands.
And PowerShell can accept C# commands as well, correct?
PowerShell can accept C# commands. You have the ability to actually use things like C# to go in and create what are known as PowerShell commandlets. And these are discrete pieces of functionality you can actually write within a programming language and then use PowerShell to call them. Internally, we have what we call internal dog food program for numerous things, and one of them is for beta testing games that we create for the Surface device. And in order to install those, because they're in a beta format, and we're not going out to the Windows Store to actually install them on the Surface, they utilize PowerShell commands and PowerShell scripts to install those applications on your Surface device. So again, another prime example of how a console-based application is used, even in a touch environment, to install an application on a Surface device. So,
Great. So
that was a demo of our console-based applications. And the last one that we'll take a look at is Windows Services applications. And these ones are kind of interesting because not a lot of folks realize that there are things such as service applications that are running in the background on their computers. They're not aware of the fact that there is something executing that they don't interact with. Key differentiators between Windows Services applications versus console-based applications and GUI-based applications are that there's no user interface. You don't interact directly with the service because it's functioning on its own in behind the scenes for the computer itself to perform whatever it is that it's doing. But having said that, we need some way necessarily to start, stop the applications, to configure them, and we do that through the use of GUI tools or sometimes even console applications. In the database module, if you come back and you take a look at the database module, you'll see an example of that where we have a SQL Server Management Studio, which is a graphical user interface environment that allows us to interact with the product SQL Server. In the background, there is a SQL Server service engine that is running that manages all of the information for us from the perspective of dealing with our queries, parsing the queries, performing all of the actions necessary to retrieve the data that we're getting. So that's an example of something that has a GUI, but yet there's a service running in the background. There are also, we'll take a look at a couple of services here in a moment that are specifically operating on the computer itself. And we can, again, configure them and see how some of the aspects of them work through the use of graphical configuration tools. But the service, again, still, it runs in the background, simply serving requests for processing. That's all it's doing, right? Let's go ahead and have a look at an example of some of these. So, one of the easiest ways to see which services are running on your computer is to bring up your Task Manager. And under Task Manager, if you're running on Windows 8 or Windows 8.1, by the way, you might end up with this as your initial screen at first. Just simply click on the More Details, and it gives you a more expanded view to see what's actually available on your system. Go over and click on the Services tab, and you might be surprised at the list of services that are actually running and executing on your computer. My son said to me one day, he couldn't quite understand, he said, I've got Windows up and running on my computer at home, and I'm looking at the amount of memory that's available, I've got no applications running, just Windows, and it's taking up half of my memory. What is it doing? Well, pop this tab open and have a look, and you'll see that there's all kinds of functionality, their services, there are things that are executing in the background that are keeping the operating system up and running and making things available. You know, this Windows search service is currently running. Well, what the heck is the Windows search service? Well, in Windows 8, if you bring up your charms menu and click on search, that service is responsible for providing the functionality of the search. So I don't interact directly with this service, but I have the service actually execute on my behalf when I do something different with it. You can see all kinds of different services down here. You know, there's a SQL writer, a SQL Server agent. You know, we could go through this whole list and take a look at, you know, what are some of the things that are going on in here. If we bring up this thing called the Microsoft Management Console, this becomes, or this gives us the ability, if you will, to go and work specifically with what we refer to as snap-ins, which allow us to configure some of these services. So we can, you know, there's one here that somebody had already used, which is called, you know, computer management. And if I bring this open or bring this up, we see that we have all kinds of different aspects and components over here on the left that we can interact with. If you take a look at, you know, task scheduler as an example, is a service that runs, again, in the background. It's a Windows services running on this computer, and we can go and we can schedule tasks to execute on our behalf. And this maintains timers in the background. It maintains track of dates and times and when we want these things to execute. And it handles all of that stuff for us. So we can use the task scheduler through this graphical environment configuration tool to tell that service how we want it to behave and what we want it to do. Another one that runs in the background that you're not aware of is this thing called Event Viewer. And what Event Viewer is responsible for is keeping track of things that happen on the computer. As an example, if we were to take a look, expand this, the Windows Logs folder, we have things called Application Logs. And the application logs are things that happen on your computer based on the applications that are executing. You'll notice that we have some here that are showing a warning that comes from this thing called IIS Express. These are different things that were recorded in this application log from the previous session that we did on this computer demonstrating web applications. So the Windows Event Viewer and logging service is running in the background, and it's collecting all of this information and storing it for us. So we're, in order to act or to, in order to interact with the service, we do so through a different tool. And this is really a viewer or a configuration tool.
And it might be worth pointing out that unless you know what the service does, how the service works, it's probably best not to disable it or to modify it in any way, unless you're really sure that you know what's going on. Because what could happen is as you modify that service, certain functionality on your computer will stop working or will be disabled, or you may not know what's happening because that service has been disabled. So.
Yeah, and that's a very good point, too. And one of the things that I used to use, you know, before we get into the plethora of services that are actually running on the operating system now, back when you could understand or know the discrete number of services that were actually executing, I would use that sometimes to figure out if there was a virus executing on my computer, because the virus would hide itself and run as a service. And if you would go into this services applet and you take a look at it and you go, I don't recognize that name and I know it hasn't been there before, then you could stop the service and you could, you know, right click and view the properties. So as an example, let's pop back to our computer here for a second. If I right-click the SQL Server agent and it, you know, says Open Services, it will open the Services applet, which gives me a little more specific detail on it, on the service that's running. But let's see if I can find it here real quick, so I don't bore our viewers. But the service itself, so we were looking at the agent, I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
If I right-click and choose Properties, it tells me where the service is actually at. Where, you know, so I can get more detailed information about the service to determine, is it a virus or is it a program that I installed? Is it something that I want to get rid of? But your comment, Paul, actually brings me back to something that was, I remember as I worked in one particular school where I was teaching as an instructor. We had an issue where students were sitting in the classroom supposed to be learning the theory before they actually implemented it in what was known as team time, so they would actually start building their projects. And we found that what was happening was the students were spending more time on chat applications, and back in those days it was ICQ, and they were playing music on their MP3 players, which was it Napster, I forget the name of the app that was running at the time. And they were doing this in the classroom, so they weren't actually paying attention to the instructor. So a lot of the instructors were coming back and saying, we need to do something about this. How are we going to solve this problem? So a couple of us that were programmers in the school sat down and actually wrote a service that executed on the computer, and it ran in the background. And what it did was it took a look at the IP address that was assigned to the computer at the time, because we wanted to make sure they were actually at the school and not at home. We didn't want to impact their use of the laptop at home. So it was while they were at the school, and if we knew what module they were in, we knew the time frame that they would be sitting in the classroom environment, and it would look at these parameters and figure out, are the students in the class or are they not? If they were in the class, then it went out and it started looking for these applications, and if ICQ was running and if Napster was running or whatever they were happened to be using at the time, it would shut those applications down. It would kill the applications, and we even thought we were rather, you know, comical and being really funny, and we popped up a little dialogue in the middle of the screen that said, attention deficit warning, you know, the applications you're using are preventing you from learning the material that your instructor is teaching, and this big long blurb, and they would click close and shut it down. But then they would think, well, that was kind of stupid, so they'd start ICQ up again, but we would immediately shut that application right back down again, and nobody knew enough to go search in the task manager and in services to find out what that service was that was running and shut it down. So as Paul mentioned, if you don't know what it does, don't touch it, but sometimes you might want to shut it down because somebody may be playing with your
that's
computer.
Right.
So yeah, so that's a great way of looking at it and a great way of thinking about how you should work with apps themselves. So as a result, this demo on the service apps kind of brings this module to a close. And so let's kind of recoup what we've taken a look at. We talked about the different types of desktop applications that you could expect to program, once you get out in the workforce and start writing apps. We demonstrated what a GUI-based desktop application is. Again, something you're probably familiar with using every day. You turn your computer on and work with it. We showed console-based applications. Some of you may have never seen one before, didn't know what they were. Some of you could be old hats at using the command prompt for different things. So you saw an example of what they look like. And then we talked about the Windows Services applications, what those are, how to find out where they are, and kind of how they function and differ from the other types of applications themselves. So, thanks for joining us on this one. Our next module, if you care to come back and view that one, will be module number 6, where we are going to take a look at an introduction to databases. Paul?
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.